back here on the program, and we are speaking with Pastor T.G. Morrison on this, our first platform program for 2015. And we thought that we would get someone of his ilk caliber to speak to us today on this program. I was reading a book the other day about True North. And on the cover of the book, there was a compass, and the compass was pointing north. Is the moral compass of our country broken, and we are not going true north, and true north is going the right way?
Well, I believe that in many respects, in our attempts to become a first world nation, to be able to position ourselves on the world stage, to have the kind of economic voice and or economic clout that many of our brothers and sisters in the other Caribbean territories envy, I believe that there are some things that we have neglected to keep as paramount and as important, and there are some things that we have sold out on. I believe that infrastructural development and investors' participation in the life of any country is also important. But I believe at the same time, the people, the true owners of this country ought to be positioned and empowered, to be empowered educationally, to be empowered financially, so that they can also have a place at that table, so that they can also become owners of their own economy. And I believe that the model of the way we do economics in our country is still this labor-driven model, where the masses are to supply labor to satisfy the appetites and the desires of those who are the creme de la creme. And I believe that in very many respects, we are still an elitist society, and that the wealth is not distributed equitably enough in our country. I believe that a part of this moral compass that you talk about is the role of the Christian church to be the conscience of the nation. But you see, as I tried to explain earlier, the moment the empire opens the door for the church and the church begins to interface with the empire, there is going to be fertilization and cross-fertilization. Because in my humble opinion, Brother Jones, the Christian church in the Bahamas is an elitist entity.
How is that?
Where the Christian church believes that it is the end all and be all of the truth of God in Jesus Christ, that it makes very little provision for those who are not able to stand shoulder to shoulder. Even, look, let's take my tradition. The Baptist tradition has historically been the voice of the grassroots people. It's been a people movement.
The underdogs.
The underdogs. Right now, the Baptist church doesn't speak for very many people. It doesn't speak for, I don't know what we speak for. I don't know what it is we are fighting for. I don't know who it is we are defending, because it seems as if we are more concerned to position ourselves to be ranked as the largest denomination nation in the country numerically, but in terms of prophetic influence, in terms of pastoral influence, what is it that we are doing? So that people do not recognize that here inside this local assembly, inside the Christian church banner, inside this ark of safety, here my voice will be heard. And I am sure that my leaders, those who are the representatives of God and Jesus Christ, they are going to be speaking for me. They're going to bat for me. They're going to ensure that my life is better. I don't get the sense that's what we're doing.
Yeah, but could it be that is true, because there was a time in the early 60s when we did not have majority rule, and men who looked like us were not able to get into the seat of power, so to speak. And with the broadening of the economic base, there are a whole lot of people who entered the middle class, there was almost a leveling of the playing field in terms of where you could be politically.
Yeah.
And because our parliament now is made up of common folk, this is perhaps why we have this situation.
I think that on paper, that's very much so.
Yes.
And I believe that in terms of historical factuality, it's yes. But I don't believe that the playing field is really leveled in our country.
Politically?
Politically it's yes. leveled. But economically, the playing field is not leveled. And a part of the mandate of the political directorate, in my humble opinion, ought to be to create the environment where more of its people are able to sit at that table of dialogue, be able to say, look here, I also have a stake in the economy of my country. Because the truth of the matter, Brother Jones, there aren't very many things that have changed in terms of structures and systems since a majority rule, since the independence.
Yeah, but do we have to talk about access to capital?
And yes, if
you don't have the access to capital, then you are not empowered economically.
Who are the main avant-gardes? Who are the main persons to drive or to create the environment where people can be empowered? Part of what governments are for, to ensure that, look, we educate our people as soundly as possible to give them the best possible footing. I don't believe that we are always serious about the educational enterprise in our country.
Yeah, but we have created a middle class in the society.
Yes.
And there was a time in the country when you had the poor and you had the rich. The middle class almost didn't exist. Today you have a burgeoning middle class throughout New Providence, you see it. Throughout Grand Bahama, you see people who have come into their own as entrepreneurs, as professional people, but they still do not have the kind of access to capital that they should have, even though they are, quote unquote, in the middle class.
Okay, wonderful. I'm not going to fight with you on that. What I'm going to push is that the persons who are now creating hell in our country, that age group of persons, a part of why they are given to a criminal disposition is that they don't see the hope that the Bahamas promised for the people. They don't see how they are going to be inheritors of a better Bahamas. Because what has happened, Brother Jones, is that while persons have accessed a particular door, in many respects, they have slammed that door shut and made sure that no one else is going to access this door.
But that could be an excuse.
No,
because
I don't believe,
there are many people who are not considered poor or living in poverty, who consider themselves to be marginalized because they are not able to get things. They are thingsy. They want stuff.
No, right? For me,
so materialism is one thing.
Yeah, I'm not talking, for me personally, I'm not talking about materialism. I'm not talking about necessarily being able to live in a particular community. When I talk about being able to sit at the table of dialogue to say, look, these are things that I am interested in making sure that the patrimony of my country is preserved for me and for my generation, I do not see how the masses have access to those tables. The real places where decisions are made, the real places where economic strength is touted and where economic muscles are flexed.
But they have elected people to do that for them.
Ah.
And the people who are elected to do that for them are common folk.
Ah.
And these people must understand who are elected that in order for opportunities to be gotten for the poor, then there has to be access to capital. The people who have the capital are in the main foreign investors.
Okay. Now, you said what I started to say from earlier. I said a part of good governance is to create the environment where more of the people are empowered. A part of the problem, Brother Jones, is that in my observation, in the way we do politics in the Bahamas, the voice of the MP is really only echoing what his or her party is saying is their platform. They do not necessarily speak for the people who send them to parliament. They're there to pass laws and to create the environment. They don't represent the voice of their people, because we had multiple instances, at least three or four instances last year, where members of parliament began to voice concerns that are that arose in their constituencies, and they met with resistance in their party, because at the end of the day, people are expected to toe the line. This is a part of what I mean, Brother Jones, when I say things are not getting fixed, because at the end of the day, if I am a member of parliament, I ought to ensure that whatever I say yes to is going to make my constituents, one, better, and make the Bahamas better. I don't, as someone who watches the parliamentary channel often, I do not get the impression when I hear our politicians speak, when I see them in their interactions on the floor, I do not see how they are passionate about making the Bahamas a better place and ensuring that the people who have elected them are empowered. Brother Jones, you talk about a middle class, but there are still two Bahamases, the haves and the haves not. You're talking about playing field level, but the playing field in the Bahamas cannot be level, where persons were given lands, piles and piles and tracts of land, simply because they were white, simply because they are the inheritors of descendants of loyalists and those who were people imported, whose labor was used to satisfy the appetites of the colonial masters. They still do not own their country. Yeah, we have a lot of inequities in our country, and many injustices in our country.
Yeah, but don't you see a whole lot of people are upwardly mobile in our country who are achieving, who are asserting themselves in various spheres in the society. There are a good number of people who used to be poor, who used to be marginalized, who came from the heartland communities of the Bahamas, who came from the family islands, who are upwardly mobile now and doing pretty well.
Wonderful. Yes, the short answer to that would be yes.
Yes.
But the question would be, how many of them, having arisen to those places in our society, how many of them have gone back to the communities that reared them? How many of them have reinvested in the islands from which they have come from, so that those islands can also be a place where a wealth and power is distributed? Everything, Brother Jones, is centralized. Even if we talk about what opportunities, what is causing the migration of persons from Family Islands to New Providence, to Grand Bahama, to the Abacos, because they don't have the kinds of opportunities. A part of our responsibility in a modern Bahamas, in an independent Bahamas, Brother Jones, is to create the environment where there are many new provinces in all, as many of our family islands as possible, so that our people don't have to contend with all that the trappings of life in the city.
Yes, and at the rate of sounding quite defensive, I have the Prime Minister coming on this television station this Sunday and Monday. And in the interview with him, I made the point that you are pretty much making. But he defends it saying this, that if you go to Exuma, you would see opportunities being created for people, and there is a growing economy in Exuma. If you go to San Salvador, you would see the same, in Eleuthera and places such. So there are attempts being made, in his view, to create economies in the various family islands.
Wonderful. I thank God for what, if it is so, I thank God for it. However,
You don't believe that.
I'm saying if it is so. I haven't been to Exuma recently, so I'll take your word for it. I'll take the Prime Minister's word for it as the holder of an office of sacred trust. However, how much of that economic development is still only labor-oriented? How many of the opportunities that are being created for our people still opportunities where our people are the workers and not the owners?
But here again, we are talking about access to capital. And in order to get certain things done, and at the scale that it must be done at, in order to give employment to a whole lot of people, you need access to capital.
I agree.
And the hard fact of the matter is that people who look like us, we have not had the access to capital. Capital has been very limited. Money has been very limited to us.
Okay. Now, and black people are running the country. So who's stopping the access to this capital?
No, but they don't have the capital. The capital, in many cases, is capital coming from outside the country.
That's what I wanted to push you to actually say.
Yes.
Because what I'm trying to get you to understand is that the way empires operate, Brother Jones, and right now the 21st century is run by the empire of money. And those who are the shakers and movers on the world stage are still likened unto the colonial masters. And
yes.
At the end of the day, they still see us as their servants. We do not have self-determination. We do not have economic power. We do not have intellectual power. Yes.
Yes, we one, do.
Yeah, but Jones, I'm talking about carte blanche. I'm talking about without the restrictions, without the inhibitions. You have what they allow you to have because at the end of the day, they are the people with the purses. And this is a part of what I'm saying. And I'm saying with the limited resources, how is it that only some people could get access to the Bank of Bahamas and the Development Bank? How is it that only some people ever hear about scholarships that are available for them to become better? How is it that only a certain pool of people seem always only to have access to government subsidies and all these other things that are available to the, that ought to be available to the masses? And I come, Brother Jones, now, you know, there are many disparities in our country. And yes, there are some people who are very passionate, who are doing a lot of good without sounding an alarm, but I'm suggesting that a lot of persons who have a lot of money in our country, they have bite into the same model of the colonial masters, that we keep our people in certain classes. So the money is operating in a particular pool with a particular set of people. They intermarry, they create business alliances across certain lines, but the masses are still blockaded from accessing that economic might.
One of the things that you said on Watch Night, you challenged your congregants to save. And this is a good time to talk about, since we're talking economics, about personal responsibility for where you are and how you can empower self. Because we are living in a society where we believe, apparently many of us, that we must wait for the politician to empower us. And there are certain things that we have within, that we can do ourselves to empower us, like saving, cooperating, pooling resources, to do some of the things that we should be about to make ourselves better economically.
I agree with you, Brother Jones. In fact, one of there were 3 points that I raised from the passage, looking at 2 Kings 19, begin at verse 29, I believe it was. And I challenged God's people, first of all, if we're going to function in this new economic climate, we're going to have to learn how to satisfy.
Mm-hmm.
But a part of the challenge, Brother Jones, is that we have been fed a diet that, look, a part of what it means to be first world, a part of what it means to be able to hold your own is to be able to say you have certain things. When I was a younger boy, it was simpler for us to satisfy because everyone in the community was basically poor. And nobody, my mom would say, Peter wasn't a bit better than Paul. And we were able to satisfy. We were taught how to satisfy. To try to get a people who have developed an appetite for the finer things of life at any cost or at all costs is going to be very hard. Mm. But we are going to have to learn how to satisfy. 7.5% has been added since the 1st of January to our normal bills, mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. So we are going to have to learn to satisfy. There are some things that we are going to just have to settle and say, listen, this is what I can afford at this time. The second thing I challenge the congregation is to learn to strategize, in which where I also talked about saving. To be able to save. The challenge, Brother Jones, is if I am already at the bottom of the economic rung and I have all hell struggling to pay my legitimate bills now, how am I going to save from what I don't have? Only people from Acklands could get oil or the soda crackers. And you understand what I'm saying. So things are tough.
Yeah.
But Jones, there are people who are working honestly, working diligently, and they are struggling to meet their basic needs.
That's
to
right.
keep their light on, their phone. And we're not talking about people who squandering money or doing foolishness. We're talking about people who are really conscientious. We are going to have to determine in ourselves, look, how am I going to make this dollar stretch? How am I going to, and I challenge the congregation, and there's something that I have to challenge myself, to save. If you're only making $10, my God, put on a dollar. We have to learn to save. And the third thing,
That means living within your means.
Absolutely. And a part of what...
And start being materialistic.
Well, a part of the challenge, Brother Jones, is that materialism is how people view success. You are perceived as successful because of what you have, of where you live, what kind of car you drive. So we have to deconscientize ourselves from that kind of mindset, where we learn that the person who lives in Pine Field, Acklands, who living off of the land, they are as successful as a Brother Jones, dapper in a nice tie and nice suit. We have to begin to cut away that myth of what is success, because a lot of people are trying to apprehend something that is a farce, that is false. And the church has helped to peddle that mindset with the kind of gospel, and those who preach that kind of garbage. We have helped to create this mindset.
The so prosperity gospel.
Absolutely. This gospel that does not mirror Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Does not mirror Jesus Christ.
Yes. Right.
And the third thing I challenge the congregation to do, look, is to soberly invest. To find creative opportunities to make your money make money. And that's a part of what we're going to be doing at Zion this year. Creating the environment where people can learn how to cause their money to make money. How to save and how to make money from your couple dollars. Because you can't help people if you ain't got no money. I shared with the congregation a very embarrassing experience that I had, which I won't share on TV. But the church has to have money to be in a position to help people. And the church also has to practice serious stewardship.
Let's take our final break on the program. Reverend T.G. Morrison is our guest on the program. We'll come right back.